Okay, folks, it's just great to see you again. I'm very pleased to be back, and I regret not being here last week. I'm still working my way through a huge amount of email. And if there's anything really urgent that you need to speak with me about, if possible, you can talk to me after class. Or if you're not able to make class, send me mail, and I'm keeping up with new mail coming in addition to going back through the backlogged earlier mail. So I'll be glad to meet with you this week. I'm most of the way better. Unfortunately, my wife has caught it for me, and as have two or three of my students, which is really unfortunate. And some of them are still out, but I should be in and able to meet in the next bunch of weeks and in the next few days for sure. So today's lecture marks the final lecture on programming language mechanisms that we're going to see. And depending on whether I can finish it today, it's possible it might go into next time. And it has to do with this language, Scala. I posted the final assignment, and you'll find that many of the elements on there involve familiar territory. So Java 8, and now from last week, aspects. But you'll also find a component of it, a significant component that draws on this language, Scala. And my goal today is to introduce you some to Scala mechanisms. Now, I recognize that coming up to speed on a new language, whether it be Python or Java 8 or Scala, is not easy. And so in the final assignment, I've provided you with a template where it has a lot of Scala code that I've written for you that you can just use. And in addition to meaning that you can focus on contributing a smaller bit of code, you can also use that code to kind of learn some of the syntax and the use of common Scala elements. But today's lecture, I'm going to be really doing an overview of the language. Now, the reason I chose Scala is because it's in very high demand. Well, here, I'll go to the next slide here. It's a multi-method language in very high demand right now, demand which outstrips supply. It's a relatively sophisticated language. Python is a language which can be appreciated by people with very little exposure to programming. It, in fact, is being introduced starting next year as the entry language for our program. In first year, they're replacing the use of C, C++ with Python. And that's because it's kind of a gentle slope language. You can learn your way around Python with very little computational background. Scala is different. Scala is a language that, to appreciate it, you're best equipped if you have a background in computer science. But if you do, and you learn some features of language, you can do amazing things with this language. It's particularly attractive for use in large-scale data applications that many of you may end up going into the field that's sometimes called big data or data science. And if you're working with data from the Federated Co-op here in town, on sales across the province, or if you're working with data in International Road Dynamics in town from collected data on vehicle traffic, or if you're working on data from the Canadian Light Source right here on campus, and in many other areas, you'll find this interest in data science. And Scala is one of the premier languages in the data science area. It's really good for manipulating large amounts of data. It is also very elegant and very sparse in some of its notations. In Scala, they did some surgery and they eliminated the cancer of the semicolon that has afflicted C-based languages since their start. So semicolons in Scala are very rare. But more than that, you can write quite a lot of Scala code with very modest amounts of type annotations, indicating what type things are, because it has this way of figuring that out automatically that's very powerful. And what that means is that your code, like in Python, can be a little bit sparser. You're not putting all these declarations many, many places about types. It also works with the Java Virtual Machine, which means it's totally interoperable with Java. You can have one project where you have part in Scala, part in Java, and part in other languages that target the JVM, and they'll work interchangeably. And in fact, in Scala, you can just directly use Java libraries. You can use your familiar classes in Java without difficulty. It does have strong support for parallel programming. We'll see a nod to that. And it supports optional laziness. So you can, using two different keywords or two different mechanisms, you can say, okay, I don't want this to be computed until I need it, and or optionally, I don't want it to be computed until each time I need it. And then finally, and very nice, there's an availability of a read-eval print loop. What that is an interactive mechanism where you can type Scala code and evaluate expressions just by typing the keyword Scala. So if you install Scala, you have a Scala, and it's sometimes called an interpreter, but it's not really, because it actually takes your code that you enter into it, A plus B, and it actually compiles it and then runs it on the JVM. But you can do it interactively. You can explore things. You can get answers back immediately. You can try out some of the examples I'm going to be giving in this lecture. Okay, so Scala's really attractive as a language. And I would note and emphasize that it spans between the object-oriented sphere and the functional sphere. It has great support for functional languages. Also really nice object-oriented support, in some ways richer, ladies and gentlemen, than Java. It supports, for example, mixins, which are a really nice mechanism for reusing implementation in a powerful and flexible way without a lot of the penalties often associated with use of inheritance in Java. But it also supports procedural cases where we're calling off to things to do to operate on arrays or collections. Okay, so I'm going to be going through a bunch of different things within this lecture, a bunch of different aspects of the language. We're going to hit on types first, and that will include discussion of collections, a discussion of functions and the sort of type hierarchy, some aspects of companion classes, etc. And then we'll go on to discuss other aspects of language, including syntax, statements, and expressions, that sort of stuff. Okay. So Scala is entirely class-based. Everything in Scala is a class. A literal one is a class. 3. Or a, 3.14. That's actually an instance of a class, I should say. It's an instance of a class. So that has a bunch of implications. You can call methods on it. You can parameterize the type bytes. You can have a list of int. Even though it's a value, you can have a list of it, etc. There's two distinctions within Scala in terms of broad types. One is what we call value types, and these are types where we don't have a reference, but we actually have the value in hand. So instead of, having our number over here sitting in the so-called heap and us having a reference to it, this would be, a reference situation. For value types, we're just directly manipulating the value in a variable, say. And we don't have to stick it on the heap. We don't have to have a reference to it somewhere else. If we have a variable, the value can live there, okay? excuse me. And for these, there's a bunch of built-in ones. Float, double, boolean, char, etc. ones we know and love. And then there's this one called unit, which is, it's kind of a value where you don't care what the possibilities are. And it's often used to represent things like what void would be, okay? And the idea here is that you can pass in a function which returns unit and use it as if it's returning a value, even though you don't care about that value, okay? So it's better than just having void as a special case. You can't pass it in if it needs something that returns a value. Instead, it's this unit value. So it kind of means void isn't a special case. It's just that you can get the same thing by having a value you don't care about. Okay, so that's one set of things, value types, okay? The other set of types are what are called reference types. And this is familiar stuff because you see it in Java all the time. It's what we get when we have a Java class and we create instances of the class. We have references to things in the heap, okay? References to things, and we can have multiple references to them. And some of those things might be mutable. They can be changed. Other things aren't. We have null in a familiar way as a distinguished value here. And then we have what's called Scala object, which is a reference, but all of our user-defined classes go beneath Scala object. These include a bunch of collections and so on we'll be talking about. So we have something like this, and I don't know how well you can see it, but this is from the official Scala language site. We have any, and an any can be either a val or a reference. And then there's a Scala object where all of our classes go and some others as well. And then there's this any ref that come from Java, for example, java.lang.string is in any ref, but it's not a Scala object. It's another sort of reference. And we have null values that can be used for any of these. And then there's this nothing value that we may come back to later in this lecture, which represents the absence of any quantity. Okay, so a couple notes on types. Scala makes use of type inference. And what that means is it tries to figure out the type of things, and it's very clever for figuring out the type of things that you're dealing with. So you don't have to tell it about a lot of things. It figures it out from the return type of the thing that you're calling, or figures it out from what is needed by the thing that you're calling as a parameter or what have you. Okay? It can't always do it, but often. So we could say something like this. Val foo equals square of 2. And if square is something that returns an integer, for example, it will know that this value foo, this kind of shorthand way of referring to this number, is an integer. Or we can indicate it like this, foo colon int. In which case we're saying foo is an integer. We're being explicit about it. Either way, it'll typically be happy. Okay. So we can mark a value as a type, or we can let it infer it. In the code that I've given you, I've tended to mark things as types so you can kind of see what they are easily. But I could probably strip out 90% to 95% of those declarations by allowing the compiler to do the work. Okay? So that's in that template code that I've given to you. Okay, subclassing, we're in familiar territory. This is language in the C family, and you use extends. And if you have a method that overrides another method, if there's a method you're inheriting from in a superclass, and you want to define a new version of it, you will need to say override. Okay, that's something which for many, many Java versions has been optional, but here it is required in Scala. And one of the things you'll find is widespread use of what we call the equivalent of generics in Java, or templates in C++, type parameterization. So you can say, for example, array of int or list of int. Okay? So in the code that I've given you as a template, you'll see quite a lot of this being used. So an array of an array of ints, for example, for two-dimensional. Now, interestingly, you can specify, for example, this is an array of something. It has to be a subtype of this certain thing and a supertype of this other one. And there's actually a sophisticated one to this. Okay, a new thing in Scala is the use of what are called case classes. Okay, and the idea here is that these are classes which are very sweet to manipulate and match expressions, which we'll be seeing. You can kind of take them apart in that. And they're very convenient for dealing with kind of simple cases where you need a type which just wraps up some information. So they have a couple features. The one thing is that you could just provide to the constructor, or when you declare the class, these parameters that it takes. And then instead of calling new on it, you just say something like this. So this is a specification, which is something you'll be using in that final problem set. It's also something we'll be talking about probably next week. And specification, you take a left and a right element here, and this is how you create it. Instead of saying new and spec of these things, you just say and spec of left and right. So this would be a tree, and it would represent a tree where on the left is some criteria, on the right is another criteria, and you're taking the and of them. Okay, so this is an and spec, and it contains this. And maybe this is an or, and it contains two other things. And this is a not, and it contains something else under it. But here, we could just create it like this. And then, when we have a match expression, we can take it apart, and we can say, for example, for an and spec, whose left and right component are this, and then we can use left and right. Probably see an example of this later, so I won't belabel it right now. Okay, now one thing you will see in that code is what is called a companion object. So the idea here is we have a class, and classes in Scala cannot contain static quantities. So we can't have a static member of a class, nor can we have a static method of a class. We can't have a static field or method. If we need that, we put in what's called a companion object. Okay, so we have a class C, a class C, and this has lots of good things in it which operate on instances. And then we have an object C. And this is all the stuff that would be static for this class. Notice they have the same name. So these are equal. And here, we would have things that would normally be static in Java. So there's a bunch of methods. So these are, you know, quote, static things in Java, okay? So this object C handles static methods. It handles static fields for that class. And we can refer to those as if they're in the class. We could say C dot a method name, for example. And it will let us refer to them. Okay, so one area that this might be useful for you in your work is you can define a main function in there. Okay, so this is how, if you have your equivalent of hello world in Scala, one way to do it is to define a main function in a companion class. Another way to do it is to derive a companion class from app. And I've provided that in the template, in fact, from a class app, which will let you run it. So here you can define static fields, main, etc. Okay, these are friends to the main class, so they can access, they know the structure of the main class, and they can access things within it. And you access them like this, c.foo, even though they're a companion, not the class itself. Both have the same name. Okay. So, for example, here's Conway's Game of Life. This is in the example I gave you, I think, in the template. Okay, so we have a companion class to Conway's Game of Life. Conway's Game of Life
life is the class that you're going to be filling in many elements, and you say extends app. So this is a companion class extending app, and here we print out some information. This is kind of the main within it. It's static, just like in Java, you declare a static main static main method to start the program. Okay, so this calls off, this allocates here an instance of the full class, and then it calls simulate on it. And I think I've given you simulate as part of my template. Okay, so you could see that. We'll come back to what this is. This is declaring a value of type game life that we're then manipulating. Here's another companion object that I provided to you. So here we have a class, and then we have a companion object to the class that calls off to that and keeps track of some static information like a map between command line arguments and different rules, and then we have a static method which basically, given a command line argument, looks up in this map the appropriate rule to use and returns that rule. That's compute live in this rule. So this is all in Scala, and I've provided you this code, most of it provided you. So companion class, because this stuff is static, we don't have many instances of this compute liveness rule, each of which, we don't have each instance having a map from command line argument to a rule. That's a static thing. There's only needs to be one of these maps which says, given this command line argument, use this rule. And that's what's in this companion object. Does that make sense? There's only one map that needs to go between command line argument, the string, and the rule. We don't need that for each instance of a rule for it to maintain a map like that. It's just one of them, and therefore it goes in a companion object. It doesn't go in the main class. So it goes in this guy here, and then static stuff, rather than in each instance of the class. The class is for things operating on instances. The companion object is for things operating that are static. Make sense? People okay? Okay. It will be useful. Okay, let's talk about functions in Scala. Functions in Scala are sort of Java 8 done right, in a way. I kind of think of them that way. They're nicer. They're easier to work with. They're easier to kind of describe their type. They're not bolted onto the language. They're built in from the ground up in a useful way. So there's a brief notation for declaring methods, and it looks like this, def. So you define a function, and there's two types of things you're going to be defining. One is, and this is in your code, one is a function, and one is a procedure. Now, a procedure, so a function's job in life is to compute a value. It may do other things in the way of computing values, but generally speaking, as a matter of software engineering, we like to divide things up, and this is, per recommendations in the patterns area, we like to divide things up. If we have these kind of methods, we like to divide them up into two types. Things that are queries, these are sometimes called queries, they compute a value. So these things compute values alone. They are pure, meaning they don't change things underneath from them. And then there are going to be commands. These are things that are that actually do something. They change something, but they don't compute values. So these do an action. Okay, they perform an action. I don't like do, perform. How's that? Perform. Okay, and here in Java, in Scala rather, these are supported by functions, and these guys are supported by procedures, okay? And you'll see that in some other languages too. So we have this distinction between functions, and you'll notice the syntax difference. For a function, you'll have equals, and for a procedure, you won't have equals. So mind your equal signs. That indicates it's a function. It computes a value, whereas this one just performs some action. It does something. It updates a hash table, or it writes something to disk, or it puts something in a database, or whatever. Okay. Yes, you do mix them sometimes, you'll need to use one or the other. Okay. Now, in addition to declaring things using def, we can write anonymous functions in a syntax that's crisper than in Java, at least for its type annotations and to some degree for how we write it. So we can have something like this. A takes an A and it returns A squared. Alternatively, we could just write, ladies and gentlemen, we could just write A. If it just takes one thing, we could write something like that. Okay, it's quite a sparse syntax. In contrast to Java 8, the type of the functions can be written like this. You don't have to do that by function and predicate and all that sort of stuff, operator as generics. Instead, you can just write this, double an int to an int. This is a function that takes in a pair, a double and an int, and it returns an int. Or this one takes an int and returns an int. This one takes nothing and it returns an array of strings. Are we okay with that? So these are the types of functions, okay? Okay, I don't hear any objections. Okay, now, you can have methods and functions that are polymorphic that take different sorts of things and return corresponding sorts of things, for example. I'm not going to get into that here. We can have nested functions. We can have one function within another, and it will call off to these internal functions to do its job. And we can have currying. It has built-in support for currying. So you can have, for example, myAdd, and it first takes an x, and having done that, it returns a function that then takes a y and does its job. And Scala actually provides built-in support for this using that syntax, okay? And so that allows us to break up, to stage the computation, to break up our arguments given to myAdd into two pieces. So we can have, we might save away it after giving an add and use it whenever we have an event that has to be handled or whatever. Okay, couple more things. So methods that only take single arguments can be used as infix operators. So if you have a plus, and this is in a class, then you can turn it into A plus B in this infix sort of way, okay? And basically, A is the thing you'd be calling it on. It'd be like A dot plus, and B is the thing that you're giving it, okay? This is the thing you're giving it as the argument. So you could just write as A plus B. It supports that in general. And then, if you don't have an argument to an operator, you could use the syntax like this. So if you have a set, if you have something that's complement, doesn't take any argument, you could just write A set complement, okay? And here, you're calling complement on A set, you just omit the dot. And what this can lead to is a whole string of things, one after the other, where they kind of operate on the previous one. Or, with this, you could have A plus B multiplied by C, etc., in a quite natural syntax, without the dots to encumber it, and without the parens to encumber it. You just successively call it. So this omission of parens, where you omit them in this notation and this one, is quite common in Scala, okay? It's quite common. So if you have a string, for example, if you have a string S, you can call S dot to upper, and you don't have to put begin paren, end paren. You can just call this, and then you can ask for the length or something like that length. And here, the parens are optional, and it allows for sort of a successive writing out of computation, sort of a pipeline that's quite convenient. Now, there are some cases where you can't do this without all omission of parentheses because it's not clear where one starts and the other ends, and you'll have to use parentheses to make that clear. Right. Oh, yeah. Now, in Scala, you can overload certain operators. So you can define your own plus-plus operator, for example. You can define your own tilde operator. You can define your own circumflex operator, the little hat, etc. You can define these things and then use them in your code. It's a bit like C++ in this. I don't know how many people have used that in C++, but you can create your own operators that are symbolic. And so, like, you might have matrix multiply, and it uses a star. And so you can do these sort of things in Scala, but you can't easily change the precedence. There are some fixed precedence rules about what takes precedence over others that you have to abide by. Okay, now, a sweet thing for you folks for assignment 3 in your Scala coding, I think it's problem number 2, is going to be the fact that Scala supports built-in tuples. Okay, so you can build a tuple using parentheses like this. Okay, so this is a tuple that contains two things, a string and a double. Okay, this tuple in general can have many different types in it. It's an ordered set of items that can have totally different sorts. And in a somewhat a very systematic way, they've mapped out tuples up to 22 elements. And after 22, they advise use a collection. It's better to use that. But this can mix different sorts of things. Now, one nice feature of this is you can return tuples. Okay? So you can have multiple return arguments. Not just one thing returned. You can return a tuple, and then you can deconstruct the tuples. And I should have that later here. Maybe I'll skip forward to it. Hey, come on, I'll just skip forward to it. It probably should be shown right now. So you can have something like this: a comma b. So returning multiple values. If this returns a pair, this will bind A to that first element and B to the next element. Or you could say val of A, B. And so each of these is a value that is obtained, that is bound to the return values of this function. Okay? So in that code that I've asked you to write, you'll find this quite useful because you will need for certain methods to return two things. And this is a better way to do it than passing on two pointers and having them pointed to the right things. And it's a better way than returning an array that has these things. It's a cleaner notation as well to kind of bind to them. Okay, so you'll want to use this in your code for sure. Multiple return values, and this reflects the fact that we have tuples built into language. Okay, let's talk about collections. Scala provides a rich set of collections, and there's basically three categories of collections that it provides, okay? And this, also from the Scala Lang site, summarizes it better than anything else I know. So we have sets. These are things where you're either in it or not, and they're mutable or immutable, depending on the situation. Map. Or depending on the class involved. We have maps, hash maps, list maps, tree maps, sorted maps, and then we have sequences of various sorts. And these include some linear sequences like lists and streams, queues and stacks. But then we also have some ones that are indexed. We can look into it at a certain element. And these include arrays, ranges, numeric ranges, which are kind of generalization of ranges and vectors. It also includes strings, because we can look into a string at a certain character. So basically, we have maps, sets, and sequences in their varieties. Okay. Those categories will be important for defining equality. So generally, these are type parameterized. So you can have, for example, a set of elements of T, of type T, a set of ints, a set of strings, a set of, you know, hash tables or what have you. You can have maps. Maps are parameters. What do you think the parameters are for a map? If we had a map class, what do you think you give it as type parameters? Anyone? What do you have to tell it for it to know how it's going to behave? What sort of type information? You have to tell it the type of the
keys and values.
The keys and the values. It's the keys and the values you're going to tell it. So it's not just one thing there, but it's two things. And those are going to have different types. So you might have something you look up, it's a string, and you get back a rule, a liveness rule. Or you take in a string, and you get back some person, what have you. Okay, and then we have sequences, which by and large are typed parameterized. So we have a list of things, we have a stream. These are just like Java streams, Java 8 streams, but just more built into the language. We can have a queue of people, or a queue of doubles, or a queue of classes, or what have you. But then there are some of these that are specialized. For example, range here, that's specialized to ints, okay? In contrast, numeric range can be for different types and type parameterized. Okay, most of these are type parameterized, and we, again, write it with this. The ladies and gentlemen, this square bracket syntax is used less in Scala than in C or Java, where it's used for array indexing. Array indexing in Scala would be written in this sort of way. So we might have an array I, maybe it's a two-dimensional array, and we write ij. We actually use parens, okay? So this is array indexing. You'll need that for your work, okay? Array indexing. Okay, so collections come in various sorts. Some of them are lazy. What do I mean by lazy here? Here specifically I'm meaning not evaluated until it needs to be. Give me an example of something that's lazy. What's that? A begins with an S, ends with an M. Stream. A stream is a good example of something that's lazy. You can have an infinite stream. Ladies and gentlemen, laziness gives us two things. First of all, we don't have to do work if we don't need it, so it can improve our efficiency. Maybe we don't need most of the values. We only need the first couple. But it can allow us more generally to express a computation that is of unlimited length without the need to kind of bend over backwards and somehow limit it right now or whatever. So we can express something. Just because it's of unlimited life doesn't mean we shouldn't be allowed to express what it is. And then, yes, we could figure out what subset we want to use. But we don't have to be hampered by knowledge that we're limited to the first number of elements in expressing it. We can sort of write a very general expression and then figure out how much we need at different times or what have you. So laziness helps in performance, but it helps in expressiveness as well. So they differ in whether they're lazy. They differ in whether they're mutable, whether they can be changed, whether they can be updated, okay? Now, you can use the equality operator, equals equals, in Scala. And you can compare whole collections. And collections, as you might expect, of the same type, like a list, they're equal if their elements are equal, okay? So if you have two lists, those lists are considered equal if their elements are equal. But ladies and gentlemen, it can do better than that. For example, here, we could compare a range with a numeric range, even though they're of different sorts, or an array with a vector, and it will actually compare element by element if they're the same. Even though they're different types of things, they are both sequences. And so it will do that. Even a list can be compared with a vector. Okay, so the idea is if they're in a different category, by category I mean sequence, set, and map, if they're in a different category, they're considered not equal. But if they're in the same category, it will use equality of elements to see if they're equal. Okay, which provides a way of a sort of more general notion of equality. Now, interestingly, if we're given a collection, maybe it's an array, we can then operate on that array in parallel, or on that collection in parallel, on that stream in parallel, by writing, so maybe S is a stream, okay? We can write S dot par dot filter, for example, or S dot par dot reduce. Or we can undertake operations on array, summing up an array. So we could say, you know, A dot par dot sum, for example, to sum up its elements in a parallel fashion. Okay, and it's innocuous, it's small, innocuous. I mean, it's small, it doesn't, you know, have a lot of showiness associated with it, but it's extremely powerful. And you can use it on the read-eval print loop if you wanted to create a little range from 0 to 10 and do par and have it print out each element. You'll see they're in different orders sometimes. Different threads will handle different components of this sum. Or if you have, you know, A dot par dot par dot for each, something like that, and you give it a function to apply to each element, you'll see that they're done as according to the natural order from different threads that are handling them. And you can do this for a collection. This is, again, using a sparser syntax. We're not calling it, we're not doing dot here because we're using this postfix syntax. And then here we pass it a function to apply to each method. Okay, so let's talk about some particular collections. Streams
in Java are built into Scala are built into language in a way they're not with Java. And you can build them up quite nicely using this sort of syntax. So we can have a stream built up, you know, first element is A, and we can use this syntax here to define, you know, a set of other elements. So maybe there's already an existing stream like this. And here we have a stream that consists of A followed by these other things. You can kind of think of this hash operator, sometimes it even grays this out as a result of putting the hash, indicating this isn't yet have to be computed. So we might do, for example, instead of this being a variable str, we might do, you know, a colon, you know, foo, and this returns a stream, right? We pass it some arguments and it returns a stream. This thing isn't computed yet. It's computed when we need it, when we need it accordingly. So vector, ladies and gentlemen, is a linear sequence. It's right over here. So this is a linear sequence. It's in this index sequence. It is linear, but it's indexed by an operator or by a value, and it's notable because it has very fast access to the head. But if you're going to look into it further, you're going to take a time that's linear in the depth of the thing you're looking at. There can be ranges. So, for example, you can define ranges like this: 0 to 100 by 2. And that will define a range, 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, etc. You can also, with a nod to Python, have this, until sequence m, n. And basically, this will allow you to go up to n minus 1, the element just before n. An array is a familiar thing. For your assignments, you're going to want to use multi-dimensional arrays, which are indicated like this. So you say array dot of dim, it's an int array, and it takes a number of a count of columns and a count of rows, and that will give you what's indicated. This is the type of it, array of an array of int. So this is a two-dimensional array. You can then access it like this, array to I and J, just like what I've written over here. Okay, so arrays of particular types can be defined in one dimension and multiple dimensions. And you can use this to create it. This will create an array. Array dot of dim this thing. Well, actually, it'll create. It's not a type. This is the type of it. Array of dim. But this is how you create array of dim. Okay, lists. Like streams, you can build lists out of components. So you might have a list where you have A in front, and it's followed by this existing list, you know, some list that you have, list B, right? So we have some existing list, and this builds a list where this is the first element, and these are the subsequent elements. So we can, it's kind of like cons in Racket or Scheme or Lisp. Map. Map creates a map. It's like a dictionary. It maps from keys to values. Okay. Here we can, for example, define a map which defines the names of functions and gives the functions which are there. So this takes in a string and it returns a function. And you'll notice that I've labeled these I've decorated them with type information, but again, we could get rid of a lot of type information. So this is a map here, and you notice this is the actual syntax. So it supports actually this sort of syntax inline where you specify what it's from to what it's to. This is how you can specify elements of a map in a very neat form. Specifying what the key is value and what the key is and what the value is corresponding to it. Okay, so this is a collections hierarchy, and they're very powerful. Now, let's talk about laziness. Scala supports two types of laziness. And the first type is particularly of note in these collections, particularly for stream. And that's what we call by need. Okay, need laziness versus by name laziness. Let me distinguish the two. By need laziness waits until it's needed to compute it. Once it computes it, it remembers it. It doesn't have to recompute it every time. Okay. Here you only evaluate once, and it's almost like it saves away the value, caches it, so that after that, you know, it's the real value. By name laziness actually means that when you use it, each time it evaluates it. Each time it goes through and evaluates the expression that gives rise to it. Okay, so the way in which we indicate that is we write something like this. X and colon, and this is the type, and you'll notice that two signs, an arrow, to int. And what this means is it's a by name parameter. And conceptually, it's like associating it with a lambda expression that doesn't take anything as an argument. It just wraps it up. And every time x is needed, it reevaluates this expression that's used for it. It reevaluates it every time it's needed. So if you give it a formula, ladies and gentlemen, you pass foo in where x is given by a formula, it will reevaluate that formula each time to get a new value. That formula may give different values over time. Maybe it's looking something up in a database. Maybe it's computing something based on the state of the system. And it will use a different value. This by name, it's not lazy in the sense that you compute it once and only when it's needed, and then you use that value from then on. Here, every time you need it, it's recomputing a value for it, and that value might change. Okay, this is a by name type of laziness, and it is supported in Scala by this. So if you pass in a call, if you call foo with a call to bar on some arguments, then it's going to remember this call. And every time you ask for this argument, x, it's going to be calling bar on this thing and computing some values. Does that make sense? It's going to be recomputing it every time. It remembers this expression, so it knows it has to reevaluate it. Occasionally, we like to do that. It's something that goes way back in the history of programming languages. Most languages these days have not used it by the default, but Scala supports it as an option. Okay, it's quite nice. In a way, you could think of it as doing the following. The way in which you could think about it is, it's almost as if when it gets this, it's a byname parameter. What it secretly passes in beneath the surface, ladies and gentlemen, is something that goes like this. It takes in nothing, and it evaluates what's ever here, this bar of this thing. Secretly, it's like this is being passed in. So every time you need the value of x, it's just saying, make call x, and it evaluates this. It doesn't need anything, and it returns that. Each time you call it, it reevaluates that. It doesn't need anything to do its job, and it will reevaluate it. You can kind of think of this as equivalent to this if this here is, if we have foo, where it's taking x, and it's one of these by name parameters. Okay. So Scala does support that. The most common type is by need. That's what streams support. It will evaluate it when you need it, but not before. And that's what allows streams to be so powerful. Any questions on laziness here? So this is supported by lazy keyword. You can just say, ladies and gentlemen, lazy of x. This could be a value. So it's a lazy value within your code. And you have some argument for it, and when x is needed, then it will evaluate it, otherwise not before. Maybe x is never needed. Maybe by the flow of control, it never actually needs x, in which case it won't actually compute it. So this lazy keyword, you could just mark something as lazy. Mark a value as lazy. Does that make sense? Okay. It's a good thing. Okay, let's talk about variables and values. This is one of the things to be most obvious to you when you look at from Scala code. Man, I feel like livening this up. Do I have some Scala here? Let's go get some Scala in here. Okay. No, I don't want to go there. So give me a second here. And hey, man, what the hell? Okay, my Z drive is on the fritz. Okay, this is not a good thing. Bad things are happening. Well, I'll have to switch over to Linux land, where things are sunnier. Give me a minute here, and I will go over and we'll get us some Scala over on Linux land. Okay. Here we go. No, you don't want to see that. That's the answer. Or maybe you do. Okay, so let's here's some Scala. There we go. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the most obvious things you'll see in Scala are these sort of things. Funnel, var, or val. These are going to be very obvious within your code, these vals, okay? You're also going to see variables used. But a lot of cases where you would normally just declare a variable in Java, you will instead see a val declared. What's going on there? That's what I want you to think about. What's going on? Well, it turns out that in Scala, we distinguish two types of things which are often conflated. They're often just used together. We often don't make the distinction in a language like C or C++ or Java. We just don't make this distinction. How are we using a variable? Is it just a nice thing to hold a value, a short name for a value? Or is it actually something that's going to be changing, where we need it to be updated over time? And in Scala, for good reasons, including optimization, it distinguishes these cases. So you have vals and you have vars. And if you look at them, they're easy to mistake, you know, visually. A val versus var. But they're quite different, okay?
A value is just a nice shortened name, convenient name for a value that you can use on an ongoing basis. It isn't modified again. You specify it up front, and then you can use it. It's quite similar to, if any of you have taken the compiler course or programming course, programming languages, advanced programming languages, where you used Racket. This is quite similar to the notion that you use there. And Haskell as well. The idea is you bind a name to a value, and you use that to indicate that value. But you're not updating this thing. You're not updating D. It's just it's this name. It's a nice, brief, expressive way to refer to the value. Well, in this case, D isn't awfully expressive, but in other cases, it will. So here we have these values, right? We can refer to these. And you can put a type or not. It will try to do type inference. Okay, the second use, which is quite different, is declaring variables. Now, for variables, ladies and gentlemen, we actually have a place that it lives in. You know, there's a home for it, a piece of memory associated with it, where we actually store the value. And later we'll come back. I don't want to put pi there. That would be a bad thing. So it's going to hold the value too. There was a Fortran instruction manual that talked about Hollerith constants in the early 70s. And it gave as an example of a Hollerith constant. If you have a value for pi and later you want to change the value for pi, you know, you can do it this way. But generally that's not a good thing, to change the value of pi in the middle of your program. So ladies and gentlemen, here we have a variable, and the variable V is going to refer to this little area, and over time it will get changed, right? It will maybe get changed from 2 to 3. If this is the sort of situation where you want an aspect of state, there needs to be state changed over time, then you will want to use a variable, and this is like a counter, and you'll be counting on it. It's an aspect of the state. A value is an aspect of the current environment. It's sort of what D means. It's just a shorthand for this value. So variables and values. Variables hold quantities that we could have indicated with a value, but those quantities will change over time. Okay, so variables and values. Let's talk about some prosaic things. Reading and writing text files. So ladies and gentlemen, to read files, you can do so very nicely with scala.io.source. You can say get a source from file. And having done that, you can say get the lines. You can then loop over the lines. For example, four lines within this lines iterator that you get back. Or you can put lines into an array with lines dot this lines iterator dot to array, and I'll put them all into an array for you. And you can write to a file using print writer like this, and then you could write lines into it, etc. Let's talk about strings in. I might run out of power. And if I don't hold back, I might run out of power by the end of the day. Okay, here we go. Okay, so let's talk about strings, ladies and gentlemen. Strings are, again, something that you're going to be manipulated. And strings in Scala are actually quite, depending on your generation, you might say neat, cool, or sweet. Okay? So strings support char add operator to obtain a character. But they have lots of other things, including substring operators, etc. And you can, you know, call dot length or omit the parens to get the length of it. One of the nicest things about strings in Java is what's called string interpolation. And this is very nice, very nice. Okay, so with string interpolation, ladies and gentlemen, it's a little bit curious, and we actually saw it earlier, probably when I was flipping through that code. But you put a string, you precede the string with a character, S, F, or R, okay? And that indicates what sort of string you want this to be in terms of its rules for substituting things and for interpreting what are called escape characters, things like backslash n, et cetera. So maybe the simplest one to talk about is substitute variables, okay? So here we indicate with an S, and then we can have dollar sign in the name of a variable or a value in Scala. And what it will do is it will stick in the actual value there, okay? So dollar sign V, if there's a value called V or a variable called V, it'll actually stick that appropriate value into here with the default formatting. So in this case, rather than littering this with a printf where we have dollars or where we have percent sign s, you know, here percent sign d, and substitute things in later, which gets hard to kind of match which of these guys at the end go with which of these guys. Instead, you just have the name in line of the appropriate variable, and it will substitute it in for you at runtime. So that's S. F, you can further provide formatting strings that govern how they're substituted. And then R is like S, but it also won't interpret. So if you have like a backslash N, it will include that as backslash N. It won't turn it into a new line character for you automatically, okay? So you don't have to do backslash to indicate backslash, it's just backslash with an R. So these strings give you flexibility for how to characterize things in Scala in terms of substitution and in terms of interpretation, okay? Very handy here. Okay, now statements and expressions. Maybe I should have started with this, but I'm of two minds about that. Okay, so statements and expressions in Scala are a little bit different from what you've been dealing with. First of all, statements are actually expressions. What do I mean by that? What do I mean by the fact that a statement is an expression? Well, a statement computes a value, ladies and gentlemen, in Scala. And whole function bodies compute values. And instead of saying return of a value, it actually just takes the body and returns the thing that was last computed, the last expression. And it turns out this sounds weird, but it has some real benefits. Okay, so let's talk about some of these aspects. This has sort of strange factoids. Unfortunately, I put this here. There's no plus plus and minus minus operators, okay? So you have to say plus equals one or minus equals one. The idea was to force you to have the equals there so it's obvious. And exceptions can be handled in this sort of way, try code and then catch, and then you have a case statement which can handle, for example, runtime expressions, runtime exceptions will handle some things. Let's talk about some of these constructs. One is the match construct, and the match construct is particularly powerful, and it's kind of like the C and Java switch statement is a little bit reminiscent, but is an impoverished pale cipher compared to this match construct within Scala. So you say expr match of different cases, and so this is a particularly sort of simple case, but already this will show some differences. First of all, there's this case underbar for the default. Instead of saying default, you have case underbar. Second of all, these cases don't flow through to one another. You don't have to worry about break in here. Saying break and it stops it. One of the most common bugs in C code has been where you forget breaks and these things fall through and bad things happen. There's a lot of bugs that are caused by that. And surveys of bugs have found that has a very, quite high preponderance. You can have wildcards is not the right way to say it. You can have values that handle many cases. You can have case n that is not handled up here where n is an integer. So if expert evaluates to some other integer that's not matched explicitly by one of these above there, then we will handle that case. And n is bound to the integer. In other words, the value n is the value we have, and we can use it in the subsequent expression. So this can handle other integers besides these cases where we can refer to n to be the case we want. So this is kind of the simplest form of this. And it's quite nice compared to C and C++ and Java's very limited switch syntax. Even this is quite nice, particularly this case to match things of particular types. Notice expression might return many types, and there might be things that handle ints, things that handle doubles, and each time it's bound to a particular value that we can then refer to in our code. Okay, but it gets more interesting than that. It gets more interesting than that, ladies and gentlemen. So turns out that Scala supports case classes which allow for very nice manipulation of this sort of situation, where instead of just having like case one with some defined literal, you can have case and spec. So you could have, for example, case and spec of left hand comma right hand. Don't use variable names like this. Or bad things may happen. But if you use left hand and right hand here, now it's sort of parsed up. Okay, you have an AND spec. Expert is matched in an AND spec. And it will bind the values of LH and RH accordingly. And then you could use them in here, left hand dot, you know, foo, and passive right hand, or something like that. So it'll actually match into the case class. This is the thing, it's extracting the pieces of it and allowing you to use it on the right-hand side over here. So with a case class, we can write a case, and it will actually match the elements, decompose them, and allow us to use them in a very nice way. Okay, a very nice way. But more than that, we can write arbitrary classes or companion objects where we define apply and unapply operators. And here, ladies and gentlemen, we can use these within the cases in a very nice way. So unapply here is a little bit subtle, but basically it's going to allow us to extract, to bind these pieces of this thing of interest. So here we have a twice operator, and we define two operations, apply, which multiplies it by two, and unapply, which basically, if this is a legitimate thing where it's a twice, where it's a value of twice, then we return the thing of which it is of which it is twice, n, okay, here? Okay. We'll treat it as a, we'll actually print out the value of it within it. So here, we construct it twice with the value 21, okay? And internally, it's calculating 42 from that, okay? Just like calling apply of 21 here, and you'll notice that its value here is 42. And now we're matching up that value. And basically we could say case twice of this, and it's gonna apply unapply. And here, you notice the type of this is option. This is like optional in Java 8. It can hold a value or not. If it holds a value, we indicate that with sum of that value, otherwise none. This is like an empty optional in Java 8. This is like an optional that has a value in it, and this is the value it has in it. And ladies and gentlemen, within this, twice, basically what we're doing is we're calling unapply, and we're saying, okay, is this value even. The value is going to here be this value 42. And yes, it is even. It's an even value. And so I am going to match here. I'm going to return the value sum. It's going to be an option that holds a value of 21. Why 21? It's z. Z is 42 here. Z divided by 2, which is 21. So in short, unapply here, the value of this twice of n is going to be a sum, S-O-M-E, of 21. And that it is to that that n is going to be bound. Okay, n is going to be bound to the sum of z divided by 2, which is 21 here. And it's going to print it out accordingly. Now, you notice that these other possibilities, it says none. In other words, if this value isn't twice of anything, then this doesn't match. This case fails. The case does not succeed, and we'll go on and consider other cases. In short, ladies and gentlemen, this unapply lets you handle cases and bind values to according to two cases. We say, okay, this case applies, hence apply. The case applies, and therefore we'll use this value as the bound value associated with it. The bound value here is the number of which this is 20 is twice. So the value up here, x equals twice, is 42. And by saying case twice of n, now we get n being 21. That's the value of which 42 is twice of it. So n is 21, and we'll print it out. So this unapply lets you have custom cases which recognize situations where that are of interest, match them in a match statement, and bind values to the results in ways that can then be useful. So it's case classes are one way to very nicely use match statements. Another way, or match expressions, another way is with this unapply. It actually allows us to recognize arbitrary cases as they're captured here by a companion object twice. Does this make sense? Does this make sense? So the idea is we'd like to be able to match sort of particular situations, and that's what we've done. We've matched a situation where this value x is twice something else. And we've gotten, in the process of recognizing that, the value of which it is twice, and we've printed it out. There could be another one that's three times, right? And that recognizes whether it's three times and handles that case. Or another one that handles whether it's a prime number, and if so, it handles it in a certain way. Or if it's a perfect square, and handles that in a certain way. And we can handle that with this unapply. Does that make sense? Okay, well, I see heads nodding. So I'm going to, in the interest of time, move on here. Okay, if expressions, you will want to use them in your code for assignment three. And rather than having the C-style ternary operator, where we have, you know, A, question mark, B, otherwise, C, I've written it there, some condition, some predicate, otherwise, A, colon, B. Rather than using that, we have the syntax that's shown here. We have if cond A else B. This is a statement, but it's an expression, just like other Scala statements. So this evaluates to A if condition is true, otherwise B. Okay. So that's the type of expression you'll want to use. And naturally, A and B could be tuples, they could be maps, or what have you. Okay, let's talk about returning, ladies and gentlemen. Values in Scala are not typically returned explicitly. They're actually just the value of the body of the code. That value might depend on whether or not certain things are true, from whence the value comes. If you want to have an expression, if you want to return something, you can print that expression at the end if there's just a single flow of code. I had noted that you could have multiple return values. And just return things like this. For example, this will, if this occurs at the end of a method, or on two sides of an if statement, for example, this occurs in one of the sides and something else on the other side, it can return a tuple like this, which can then be found when it returns. So for example, here, this is from code, I guess this is a freebie. So here we have determined current and next cells. This takes in this takes in a time and it returns a pair, a tuple, which is the current array and the next array. And so if it's an even step, we have buffer even, comma, buffer odd will be the next, buffer even is the current, otherwise buffer odd, comma, buffer even. This is the value, this is the last expression in this function as indicated by equals, so it's returning this pair, this tuple. Does that make sense? This is returning, depending if it's an even step, this is a Boolean, we're returning one tuple, otherwise another tuple. Both are two tuples, so we can bind them using syntax like this. Buffer even equals, comma buffer odd equals, this determined current and next cells. Scala supports kind of similar things to list comprehensions or comprehensions in Python. So you can write, for example, for loops like this, including with guard conditions. This would be useful in your code. You have guard conditions. If I is not equal to J, for example, some body. And you can, similar to list comprehensions, we can write values equals this, and you just put a yield after it. So rather than having a body, which does something for each iteration, you just yield an expression, ladies and gentlemen, and then that defines a collection of values. So an array of values, you'll get out this collection of values by, it'll just yield this for each successive iteration through the loop, sort of create a data structure out of that, and that will be the value of values, okay? I think I'm gonna wait to discuss mixins to next time. They are neat and they shouldn't be minimized in the discussion. They allow us to break out of the straitjacket of single inheritance, but more than that, they provide a very nice way of sticking to the Liskov substitution principle on the one hand while reusing code on the other. And they draw on some fantastic work that was done in the functional language community, but underappreciated in the object-oriented community. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we'll see mixins at the beginning of next time, and then we'll go on to discuss a series of patterns that we use when building up programs systematically at an architectural and design level. So that will be next time. Finish up Scala and get going. Oh, I also posted a take-home exercise for Thursday. Again, struggle with it for up to an hour, no more. It is with aspects. And one of the reasons I wanted to get you to struggle with it, because you'll need aspects, ladies and gentlemen, for your